lifestyle and what I serve, how I serve with the yoga and the gong.
Everything, yeah.
Well, like most people, I have a wellness journey, right? How did it really begin? Well, it's a long story, but when I was younger, I'm in my 50s now, and when I was younger in my 30s, I was a very fit girl. I was into fitness and swimming and running and biking. I had a partner who we used to do triathlons, and that was a mechanism for me to de-stress and to feel good and keep everything in balance in my life. And before I became a mother, I developed a ovarian cyst, and I was here in Thailand. And so many parts to it, but anyway, I became pregnant at the same time as I found the cyst, and the cyst stayed with me for quite a while. And when I went to seek medical treatment, it was like no discussion. It was like, okay, let's just make the appointment and book surgery and cut it out. And it just didn't make sense to me. I said, well, wait a minute, but what does it mean? And if you cut it out, won't it grow back? And where did it come from? And I had all these questions, and none of them were answered. So I thought, no, I'm not going to do this. And at the same time, I observed that my immune system was really low and I was really depleted. And anyway, long story short, this is what sort of opened me up to alternative and natural healing. And it was somehow through that process, I can't remember the exact timing, but I became a mother, I became pregnant. And the responsibility of becoming a mother was what motivated me, because suddenly I had this human being I was responsible for, and I had to be healthy, I had to be well, it wasn't an option. So I started doing all these crazy things, you know, reading books and finding people doing this, and what I ended up starting to do, the cyst was not malignant, but it was filled with toxic fluid, and I was trying to monitor it. So I would go every 3 months and get an ultrasound. So I was able to stop the growth of it, but I wasn't able to eliminate it. And what I learned through that whole process and everything that I went through was that this part in the female anatomy and all these issues down here for women is really relating to stagnancy and not enough flow and all kinds of energetic things going on. And once you do have mass or something that's manifested physically, it is very difficult to get rid of. So I really cleaned up my life. Cleaned up my lifestyle. It's about the same time that I found this yoga. That's another story. But it got me on this path of wellness and looking at all parts of myself in terms of how I live day to day. The second part of it, specifically of how I came to the discipline and practice of yoga, was, you'll remember I told you I was this fitness girl. And by this time, my son was about 4 years old, and I used to put him on a little bike, and we'd go to Lumpini Park, and he'd ride his bike with me while I was running. Mom was running before work. And one day he says, Mom, you're so slow. So my ego came up, and I raced with him around that park, and I did something to my knee. I don't know what I did, but it was seriously injured. I couldn't walk, and I used to swim. I couldn't even do a full extension without shooting pain. So same thing, went to the medical provider, and same thing, it has to have surgery, can you guarantee success? No. And well, you know, I just wasn't getting the answers, so I opted out of surgery. But I had this intense pain, I was almost like paralyzed, I could hardly walk stairs, and I had this little boy at home I was trying to care for, plus work full time, so what to do? So I suddenly stopped this exercise, what do I do now? So this yoga was coming in to Bangkok, and what's yoga? I had no idea. So I went to a few of these studios that are still here today, and I, you know, classes were very good, and I had a nice experience, but it was almost stressful. You know, you walk into this big room with 20 or 30 people, I was in a little bit pain, nobody really noticed what I was doing, and I was struggling to get through those movements, and I don't know, this isn't for me. And then I kept searching, and I found this person that was doing Kundalini yoga. I had no idea what Kundalini yoga was, you know, it's this long word, but I was desperate. And the person didn't live too far from where I was, so I got on my bike, of course, my pedal bike, and I went to one of these classes. And I don't know, it wasn't, how I explain it to people was this, you know, there's a time in life for everything, but my personality, my persona, and my nature in my career and relationships, I have a questioning mind. I'm the person in the room that has hundreds of questions. And I went to this Kundalini class, and I had no questions. You know, I was doing all these mantras and postures and different things I'd never been exposed to before. And I just didn't question anything. I just knew something in me. I don't even know how to describe it. I just knew I found the energy to go back to those classes. And then after about 3 months, I was starting to do early morning practice. I was invited to join 4 a.m. practice, which is pretty disciplined. But, you know, I did it. And you start to work a little bit more deeper. And you just start to notice these shifts in your life. That's how it was for me, but it was nothing specific. It was very kind of nebulous. And that's how I began. And then all these other things through that process, I just started living. I noticed, you know, it's the kind of thing that when you get from point A to point B, and then you can look back, that you see how much your life has changed. But it was this gradual process of pulling all these different little aspects, you know, the food, the thought, the meditation, how I carried myself day to day, then how I related not only to myself, to my son, to other people, and my work relationships. It's all bundled together. And when you're in a place of not being well or feeling imbalanced, it's overwhelming. So I guess I'm moving beyond the first question, but what I want to say to you is be patient with yourself and trust and just take one day at a time, one activity at a time, and one breath at a time. And just trust that that's what you just take today for today, and you'll get to a point where you're going to look back, and that's when you're going to see how something significant has changed in your life. And that's what it's about. It's about that wholeness and that completeness. And it's not one thing. And it's just this energy and synergy of how it all comes together for you. And finding that balance, finding wellness, finding vitality in life. I'm so sorry, that was so long. You're gonna edit it, right?
Maybe.
Maybe not. You touch on probably a very key theme in any comprehensive treatment is you can't just look after the physical body.
Yes.
You have to nurture the mind, you have to nurture the soul.
Yes.
Talk us through what you think that actually means and maybe give some advice to people as to what they might be able to do at home right now.
Yeah.
To start that.
It's a very important question, Luke, because, you know, in today's culture and society and communications of what people are exposed to, this body, mind, soul thing is so out there, so overused that we're almost, what does that mean anymore, you know? And yet, it's so important and it's so significant. And I'll bring it back again to my own experience. I'm very much, like I remember I told you, I was the person who had all the questions. And I was really into fitness, I was into the nutrition, I was into my, you know, physical body and wellness that way. I didn't really get the other part of it, you know, the soul part, the spirit part. And again, just to say that, it's like a concept. And what I have to bring it to is, and how we're taught in yoga, which is so important, is it is the experience. Don't get hung up on the terminology and all these other things. That's the mind, that's the intellect, it's something very different. All you have to do is just be present. It's that now thing, being in the now. And the easiest way to do that is with the breath. We all breathe, right? You're breathing right now as you watch this. I'm breathing. So there's no excuses. We all can take a breath. Now, how you take that breath, right? Are you taking that breath consciously? Are you paying attention to the inhale? Are you paying attention to the exhale? And then the mind can go off and analyze it and dissect it and think about this and that. That's fine. Let the mind go play its games, but keep coming back to the breath. Okay? So what I'm trying to say here is, you know, when you're developing consciousness or mindfulness, it's the totality of the experience of what is important. Every persona, every human being has their own nature and how their mind works. So some of us are going to have patterns and habits of how we relate to that, how we want to understand it, how we want to dissect it. And that's okay. That's a process. It's part of how we learn and grow. But it's something much more subtle and internal. It's again coming back to that word of oneness and that totality. That's what we're really trying to experience. It's not something in the intellect. It's something beyond that. It's the same as the word love. How do you define love to someone? All you can know is if you felt it, you understand it. And if you haven't felt it, you won't understand it, right? So it's the same kind of thing. So again, it comes back to having the courage and the faith and the trust to try something new, to move in a new direction, take small steps, you know, put yourself, I was in a yoga training last week, and a woman said it very beautifully. She says, I'm learning as a trainer to put to feel comfortable in the uncomfortable, right? Because we walk around as human beings and there's fear everywhere. You know, it's how the mind works, because in the mind you have the negative mind, the positive mind, and the neutral mind. They're all very important, but they gotta work together. But the first one is the negative mind. It's designed to protect you. So it's that part of you that resists. It's a part of you that's defensive a bit and looks to protect and warn you of something, right? Now the problem with most of us as human beings, we get stuck there. Because you see, the negative mind is fastest, so it's the first thing to kick in. And if we hold on to that, then we're stuck in the negative mind. We don't move forward. We don't elevate. We don't move beyond the positive and then to the neutral mind, being able to be assess beyond all of that, right? So start to observe yourself as well, so that you keep moving forward. Keep moving forward. I forgot what the question was.
I guess my follow-up to that is, a lot of people are discouraged or afraid of mindfulness when they hear things, words like faith.
Yes.
And people that either have a faith and they're worried about upsetting their faith, or those who have no dogma. Maybe explain why yoga transcends faith, in so much as you don't worry so much if, you know, it's not going to disturb what you actually have a belief in. If
yes.
you don't have a belief-based system,
yoga is a practice, it's a science and technology for all people, all ages, all faiths, all locations. And the difference between, again, with that word of love and fear. So whatever your practices or your belief systems or whatever, how you live and what you've learned in your life, these are usually things that we've learned somewhere, or habits. You have to ask yourself, is it something that's expansive or is it something that's limiting to you? If it's expansive, it's based in love. If it's limiting, it's based in fear. And it's not, it's one or the other. There's no in-betweens in that polarity. So if you look at something and you're trying to assess for yourself, is this something I should be doing now? And feel, you know, look around you. And if it feels that it's something my point is, with all of these things, there should be no fear. If something's telling you don't do this because of don't do that, that's fear-based, right? So if you can be present with something, you'll know, and it's something, again, it's from the heart. If you're thinking about it here, this is the mind process. And, you know, in yoga we're taught to live the heart over the mind. This is a hard thing for people to take. I know, because I've got that questioning mind and a scientific mind as well, and I believe this is who I am, right? That my mind's clever. Process all these things, it's the intellect. That's not who I am. No, I'm something here. I resonate more here. This is my truth. This is an important tool. The mind's a very important tool. Don't get me wrong. And it's a powerful tool. But practices for the human condition that are elevating, that help us reach our full potential, and that are in alignment with something higher, are based on the heart. They're heart-based practices. So that's a different game. It's a different approach. And it's something, again, that comes back to experience. You have to experience it. I don't think that was succinct.
Okay.
Yeah.
Let me what is it about Thailand that just makes it such a naturally beautiful place when it comes to healing? What is so special about it? Why are we drawn to Thailand?
From someone who's been here for 22 years, I'm a Canadian national. I had never lived in any other country. Life brought me here. This is where I stayed for some reason. And Canada's an amazing place to live too. But I have to tell you, as a woman, and at times I was here as a single woman, I've never felt safer anywhere in the world. I mean, I don't have so many countries to compare it to, but I always have felt so safe here. And why is that? There's something in the culture and the nature of people that is very receptive and tolerant of diversity that you don't find other places. And emotions, for example, in Western cultures or North American cultures, I find my experience, I have to say my experience, is when things, when people get upset, it's very aggressive. Aggression comes out. That's a natural human behavior, but it's external and it's something out here. Of course, people here get upset as well, but it's something more internal. People work with it differently, so it manifests how it feels day to day is different. So it's just a different experience. It's not better or worse. But from a point of view, if you're trying to find a place to do your healing work, it's a beautiful place to be because there's a gentleness and sort of a rhythm and an acceptance and flow in day-to-day life that you don't find so many places. And it is very receptive on the surface. It's very comfortable, you know, to diversity. It doesn't mean that that's the way people really feel deep in their heart, not necessarily, but on the surface there's this gentleness and this, you know, you feel it's very hospitable, it's very welcoming. And I'd have to say that's probably why I've been here for 22 years. You know, life, my own life and circumstances just brought me here for particular reasons, but the reason I stayed is probably that, because of the culture. And so it's a very beautiful place, I think, if you have to make a choice in the world of where you want to do your healing work or you need some care.